Welcome to another episode of NBA Weekly. I am your host, Pee Wee the Plug, Big Stacks Porzingis, 1/4 through the wire, number one Knicks fan in the world, a.k.a. Mr. Know-It-All, and I think this is the biggest trade of the day. I can't believe this just happened. The Milwaukee Bucks are acquiring Jrue Holiday from the New Orleans Pelicans for Eric Bledsoe, George Hill, and what's described as a significant draft compensation, which we now know is 3 first-round picks. So the Pelicans are going to receive Eric Bledsoe, George Hill, 3 first-round picks, and the Bucks are going to receive Jrue Holiday. This is crazy. This is crazy. Woj says, besides the 3 future first-round picks going to New Orleans, there are also pick swaps included in the deal. All in all, this is shaping up to be a draft compensation package similar to New Orleans' deal for Anthony Davis with the Lakers. So the Pelicans are just, you know, they're getting their swaps and their picks up, whatever. Reactions. Out the gate, I'm talking about, this has to be one of the most shocking things ever. We knew Jrue Holiday was going to get traded. We knew the Bucks had interest. But never in a million years did I think all it would take is Jrue Holiday. I mean, Eric Bledsoe, George Hill, and some picks that are kind of worthless to Milwaukee. Their priority is keeping Giannis, competing for a championship with Giannis, and surrounding Giannis with top-tier talent that's going to complement him and his game to win the championship. And so the picks, I get it. They're picks. All first-round picks have some type of value. I understand that. But at the same time, there's nothing like young, proven talent. So when I see a trade like this happen and I don't see the details initially, I automatically assume a guy like Dante DiVincenzo is in the mix or included somewhat in this deal. So for the Milwaukee Bucks to pull this off and not have to lose a guy like Dante DiVincenzo, it's kind of mind-blowing to me. So I have a bone to pick with the Pelicans right there, which we'll get to when it's time to talk about the Pelicans. From the Milwaukee Bucks standpoint, we have to start with them. Of course, they're the clear-cut winners. I mean, when you put out a team or a lineup that's going to essentially have Jrue Holiday, Chris Middleton, Giannis Antetokounmpo, Brook Lopez, you can fill out whoever you want the fifth guy to be. They can sign a veteran wing to a minimum, and that just, as long as he can somewhat be a threat to shoot, go get another Wesley Matthews-type guy. Danny Green is somewhere with the Thunder being dangled around. If there's a buyout type thing, they can pick up Danny Green. He would work. If you want to start Dante DiVincenzo there, that'll work. Kyle Korver could damn near start with that type of lineup. So I think the Bucks have won this trade significantly, in my opinion. They not only got Jrue Holiday, a guy who's one of the most supreme defenders in the league, if not the best perimeter defense in all of basketball. You pair him with the reigning Defensive Player of the Year and back-to-back MVP in Giannis Antetokounmpo. You still have Brook Lopez, one of the best floor-spacing big men in the game. And then on top of that, you have Chris Middleton still, who is going to fit perfect next to Jrue and Giannis. And Jrue is going to fit next to Middleton and Giannis perfectly as well. Jrue checks the box as far as an upgrade on Bledsoe. He checks every box. He's bigger than Bledsoe. He's a better defender than Bledsoe. He's a better scorer than Bledsoe. He can shoot the ball better than Bledsoe. He's just a better basketball player than Bledsoe. So you just upgraded there. And like I said, the valuable thing that Milwaukee gave up isn't really valuable to them. They could care less about first-round picks. Especially when they're trying to compete for a champ, them picks are going to be late. Like this year's pick that I think they still own. I don't even think the deal, because they just said 3 future first round picks. Nothing about this year's first round pick, which is the 24th overall pick. Like, sure, there's some value there for some other teams, but for the Bucks, if you could have the next 3 picks for the next 3 years that'll be in the 24 to 28, 29 range, or Jrue Holiday, the Bucks are taking Jrue Holiday every day of the week. Taking Jrue Holiday every day of the week. So those picks have no value to Milwaukee. So I think they really finesse the Pelicans. I think they finesse the hell out of Pelicans, because that those picks are kind of, I don't want to say worthless, because you can find some good guys at the back end of the draft, and a lot of good teams do. But for what Milwaukee is trying to do right now, they kind of have their guys that they want, and they're going to prioritize and appreciate a Drew Holiday, an established all-star caliber, like I said, arguably the best perimeter deep. When you get a guy like that, and all you're giving up is a couple years of picks in the 20s, you win. And they give up Eric Bledsoe and George Hill, who are two solid guards. But I mean, I just think that they finessed them, man. I just think they finessed them. And I think there's still more out there for them to do, because they do have Dante DiVincenzo. Even if they keep Dante DiVincenzo, that's still good. But it just opens up the door for so much other things to happen. Now, if they did want to go and try to get another veteran guard or a wing player, like I mentioned, to complement the rest of that lineup, you still have Dante DiVincenzo and the 24th overall pick. You pair those together, that should be more than enough to go and get you a solidified wing player who can complement the core starting four that you already have, which is Brook, Giannis, Chris, Drew. So I think that's a hell of a win for Milwaukee. Probably the biggest bomb of the day. The Chris Paul thing was big. Portland's move for Robert Covington was big. But I must say, I knew Milwaukee had interest in Drew Holiday, but I didn't think they would have a real shot at getting him, especially if you told me they weren't going to have to include Dante DiVincenzo. That was a big one. But I think when you pair his defense up, his ability to play on the ball, off the ball, one of the most selfless, just humble guys in the league. Everybody loves Drew Holiday. He's going to fit right in with that locker room and that core. He's going to be down to work. You're putting him in a situation where he's never been in, which is he's going to compete for a championship. It's going to put Drew Holiday on a stage that we haven't seen him on yet. And we all, as basketball fans, the real basketball fans, know Drew Holiday is one of those guys. But I think the rest of the NBA world and the quote-unquote casuals or guys who aren't in it like us, they're now going to see Drew Holiday on that stage. Drew Holiday could start getting some of those accolades that he's been missing out on for playing in a market like New Orleans. You know, not that Milwaukee is such a big market, but he's playing alongside a two-time back-to-back MVP, a team that's going to win 50 games a year and probably be a one or two seed coming out of the East and potentially represent the East in the finals. So he's going to be playing a lot more meaningful basketball than we've ever seen him play in his career. I think he's an extreme upgrade. I think he's going to deliver and give them everything that they're looking for or have been looking for. And I'm interested to see the other moves that they make, knowing that they still have Dante DiVincenzo and that 24th overall pick as of now. A report can come out and say one of those three picks is the 24th overall pick. But as of now, my information is telling me that those are three future first round picks, meaning that they still have the 24th overall pick in Wednesday night's draft. Now, for the Pelicans, like I said, I had a bone to pick with them. When you trade Anthony Davis, you get a package back that is Brandon Ingram, Lonzo Ball, Josh Hart. Am I forgetting anything? I think they got another pick or something, which they was able to flip somehow with the Hawks or something. And they got Jackson Hayes. Then they had already had Zion for the first pick. So you bring in that huge haul. To me, we're just going to clump all of that together as the package for Anthony Davis. Jackson Hayes, Lonzo, Josh, and Brandon Ingram. And then on top of that, you already had Drew Holiday coming through the door. Zion coming through the door. You still had Drew Holiday there. You bring in J.J. Redick from free agency. Nice situation. Now, you still have those guys, right? You miss out on the playoffs in the bubble. Very young team. Minute restriction on Zion because he's young. You don't want to put him in a situation where his body's going to fail him at a very young age and you're giving up your future. Understandable. Now, you come into a situation where you miss the playoffs. So that means what? You have a lottery pick. Boom. Which I believe is what? The Pelicans have the 12th pick, if I'm not mistaken. Nope, they have 13. Cool. You have the 13th overall pick. You have Lonzo Ball, Drew Holiday, Brandon Ingram, Zion Williamson, Josh Hart. I think Derek Favors is a free agent. You still have J.J. Redick, Jackson Hayes, plus the 13th overall pick. And going into the offseason, You're going to give Brandon Ingram the max contract. Cool. He's probably going to get the max. You have Zion. You have Lonzo. 13th overall pick. Jackson Hayes, J.J. Redick. I still think that is a nice team. Now, you make Jrue Holiday available. No secret. Nothing against Jrue Holiday. He just doesn't fit the timeline of this young team that you guys have. Cool. So now, when you talk about the youth that you have on that team, this is now a chance to take a 30-year-old proven all-star caliber, arguably the best defender, a perimeter defender in the NBA, and flip him into even more assets or young, talented players that can fit with Lonzo, Ingram, Zion, Jackson Hayes, and your 13th overall pick. But what does New Orleans do? They do the kind of exact opposite. Cool, you're getting three future first-round picks. Just like Woj mentioned in a tweet with the Anthony Davis package, y'all have picks. You're going to get picks. Those picks aren't like game-changing picks. Like, we have to stop overvaluing picks, especially, like, yes, I understand. First-round picks are highly valuable. But they're not more valuable than already proven young players. So in my mind, how the hell do you trade somebody of the caliber of Jrue Holiday and only get back Bledsoe and Hill when you have Alonzo Ball, who you're trying to develop and grow into being your starting point guard because he complements your quote-unquote face of the franchise in Zion? I think their best player is Brandon Ingram. That's just me. But you have Zion. He complements him. You have Ingram. You have J.J. Redick, who complements that. Even though he's a vet, his shooting just complements everything. You have Josh Hart off the bench. You have Jackson Hayes as a project. Nikhil Alexander Walker. And you have this 13th overall pick who could potentially be a guy like Jalen Smith out of Maryland, who would be the ideal center to fit with this young core. And then on top of that, you could flip Jrue Holiday and go get another young player like a Dante DiVincenzo or some shit like that. You know what I'm saying? Like, or even if you wanted to ship Jrue to Brooklyn, because we see Brooklyn is trying to make that move, you could have went and possibly got a Caris LeVert. Maybe could have got a Spencer Dinwiddie. But instead, you get three future first-round picks that are all probably going to be late 20s. And then you add George Hill and Eric Bledsoe? What the fuck is Eric Bledsoe going to do for the Pelicans? Unless they're going to flip him to some place that I'm not... Unless there's some move that they're going to have brewing that I just can't put my mind around. Let me check my phone while we're on here to make sure ain't no news. Like, oh, they just flipped Eric Bledsoe for... But, like, I'm so confused on why on earth would they do such a thing? Nothing about Eric Bledsoe complements what they have going on. And then you get Eric Bledsoe, not only just Eric Bledsoe, but you bring George Hill too. So now you have Lonzo, Bledsoe, Hill. I just feel like they really just dropped the ball. I really feel like New Orleans had one of the brightest futures in all of the NBA. And I feel like that move right there is going to be very instrumental to them never reaching their fullest potential with this young core. All it takes, when you look at franchises that are built, when you look at how franchises are being built brick by brick, a lot of successful franchises like Golden State, we always refer to Golden State because in recent memory, they've done it the best. They actually won a championship with homegrown talent. But every move they made played a part. Going and getting Andre Iguodala, you know what I mean? Trading David Lee and getting rid of David Lee when they did. Picking up a Draymond, starting a Draymond. Going and getting a Bogut. Signing a Sean Livingston. All of these things play big parts for them. You know what I mean? Going to get a Mo Spates. Like, every single move that at the time, it was like, oh, Andre Iguodala, that's a dope signing. But then they win a championship. It's like, damn, that changed it. That made them, like, you know what I mean? Like, every move played a part. Like, even the little moves that we was just like, okay, Monte Ellis for Bogut. Okay. But no, it's like all of these things made that, you know, very instrumental to the whole dynasty. So I feel like there's still potential there because there's so much youth. There's so much there. But that one move, this one move of not getting back some type of young proven talent that already can come in and complement, be enough, you know, just another young promising player. That roster is full of young promising players. Say what you want about Lonzo Ball. I don't care how much you don't like his dad or the shoe. Lonzo Ball is a young promising player in this league. Brandon Ingram, already proven all-star wing without a doubt. Zion, the small sample size we've seen, boom, there is some potential there. Got to get in shape. Got to learn how to play with his body and make sure he's not, you know, putting himself in a situation to be an injury-prone player. We don't want to see that, but it's just a lot of power in a small frame that we've never seen. But potential's there. Even Jackson Hayes. I don't think Jackson Hayes is some superstar in the making, but there's a potential there with that team. Rim running center, block some shots on some Tyson Chandler, Willie Cauley-Stein type shit. I think Nickeil Alexander-Walker has a lot of potential coming off that bench. Josh Hart is just one of those glue guy winning players. You have a veteran like J.J. Redick who not only compliments them on the floor, but is a locker room guy that's been around a lot of winning in his career. And then, boom, you have another 13th overall pick and a draft that's full of complimentary players, and that's exactly what you're looking for if you're the Pelicans. You're looking for guys who can complement that core that I just named. Constant complimentary players, and that's exactly what this draft is full of. They can still hit that on the head with this 13th overall pick. But I feel like, if you bring in a Dante DiVincenzo with Lonzo, you know what I mean? You have now think about this. Let's paint this picture. Real quick before we wrap it up, I don't want to take too much of y'all time. But now if they did the trade how I thought it would have happened, let's now look at what the roster could have been. We'd be talking about Lonzo. We'd be talking about Ingram, Zion, Lonzo, Josh Hart, Nickeil Alexander-Walker, Jackson Hayes, whoever you pick at 13, Dante DiVincenzo, J.J. Redick, and whoever else, however else they want to fill out the roster. Whether you want to bring back Favors, Etuan Moores, if he's coming back, you know, all these type of things. And I just feel like they let that go to add George Hill and Eric Bledsoe. And I'm just right here pulling up their roster, making sure I'm not forgetting anybody. Yeah, I mean, even guys like Frank Jackson, Nicolò Melli. I just think that there was so much potential there. I think this is a very key instrumental trade that they kind of dropped the ball on that could come back and haunt them big time. We have to understand the value of draft picks. Are they valuable? Without a doubt. First round draft picks are always going to be valuable. But it's nothing more better than already proven young talent to put with your young talent. I'm just trying to think of teams, man. There's so many teams that were interested in Jrue Holiday. But like when I think of Brooklyn, like the potential of them, like think about that. If they move him to Brooklyn and they bring back Caris LeVert, let's just say all they get is Caris LeVert and a future first round pick or whatever. And you're now talking about Lonzo, Caris LeVert, Ingram, Zion, Jackson Hayes, J.J. Redick, Nickeil Alexander-Walker. Whoever you draft at 13, that is an amazing young team. That team is as sexy as can be. That's one of the best young teams in the NBA. Still is, but it's just even better. It just makes the potential even broader. You know what I mean? Even if you talk about the Hawks, if they could somehow have traded Jrue Holiday to the Hawks and you bring back a Cam Reddish or a Hunter or a Reddish and a Herder. I don't know. I'm just throwing things out. It's just so much better than Bledsoe, Hill, three future first-round picks from the Bucks, which we all know will be from 24 to 29, potentially 30. That's how I'm going to wrap the video up. As always, appreciate y'all. I am your host, Pee-wee the Plug. If you like this type of content, please leave a like. Always leave feedback, thoughts, and your opinions in the comments. I definitely read the comments and I definitely react to some of them. If you're wild, then know if you're speaking facts. Let me know though. Am I being too hard on the Pelicans? is this the best that they can do? Do you see value in Eric Bledsoe and George Hill on this Pelican roster? You know, am I undervaluing those future first round picks? Talk to me. Let me know. Am I tripping? Is Drew Holiday still doesn't convince you that the Bucks are a favorite or a stronger contender? Let me know in the comments. If you're new, subscribe. As always, Big Stacks Porzingis, I'm out.